Random House Audible presents Selections from the O. Henry Awards 2002 Prize Stories. Edited by Larry Dark. Read for you by Ron McLarty, David Pitu, Barbara Caruso, Michael Emerson, Craig Wasson, and David Garrison.
First Prize, The Ceiling, by Kevin Brockmeyer. Introduction by Joyce Carol Oates.
It's rare that a tale of dark fantasy makes its way into a mainstream publication, and still more rare to discover such a tale in the distinguished O. Henry Awards anthology, where through the decades, that category of prose fiction we call realism has always predominated. Rarer still is a story like Kevin Brockmeyer's The Ceiling, which so powerfully conjoins the parable and the realistic short story, the horrific with the domestic. Though The Ceiling was written before September 11, 2001, it can now be read as a poetic meditation upon that tragic and unfathomable event in our history, an acknowledgement of our common humanity in the face of terror, and an eloquent, if heart-rending, testimony to the resilience of the human spirit in extremis. In Brockmeyer's small-town American setting, as finally claustrophobic as a checkerboard, there is no salvation beyond the ever-shrinking, ever more desperate stratagems of the doomed as they live out their final days. How, like all of us, they are eager to accept what would have been only just recently unacceptable. The plane of the ceiling was stretched across the firmament, covering my town from end to end, and I could see the lights of 1,000 street lamps caught like constellations in its smooth black polish. It occurred to me that if nothing were to change, if the ceiling were simply to hover where it was forever, we might come to forget that it was even there, charting for ourselves a new map of the night sky. Remarkably, The Ceiling remains a story of domestic life. A husband must come to terms with the mysterious estrangement of his wife and the diminishment of his marriage, even as the world itself is diminished, irrevocably. In the fairy tale simplicity of its narration and its ever-accelerating momentum, The Ceiling may remind some readers of certain of the beautiful classic parables of Ray Bradbury, in particular, There Will Come Soft Rains. In Bradbury's masterpiece of elliptical narration following a nuclear holocaust in which silhouette shadows of human beings baked on walls replace characters, the collapse of civilization is suggested in the slow, then rapid collapse of a house. In The Ceiling, disaster similarly descends from the sky, but there is something even more terrifying about this fate, which seems not to have sprung from a human political agent. As the narrator's wife observes, it's a kind of sudden dread. Joyce Carol Oates.
The Ceiling, by Kevin Brockmeyer. From McSweeney's, read by Ron McLarty. There was a sky that day, sun rich and open and blue. A raft of silver clouds was floating along the horizon, and robins and sparrows were calling from the trees. It was my son Joshua's 7th birthday, and we were celebrating in our backyard. He and the children were playing on the swing set, and Melissa and I were sitting on the deck with the parents. Earlier that afternoon, a balloon and gondola had risen from the field at the end of our block, sailing past us with an exhalation of fire. Joshua told his friends that he knew the pilot. His name is Mr. Clifton, he said, as they tilted their heads back and slowly revolved in place. I met him at the park last year. He took me into the air with him and let me drop a soccer ball into a swimming pool. We almost hit a helicopter. He told me he'd come by on my birthday. Joshua shielded his eyes against the sun. Did you see him wave? He asked. He just waved at me. This was a story. The balloon drifted lazily away, turning to expose each delta and crease of its fabric, and we listened to the children resuming their play. Mitch Norman slipped his sunglasses into his shirt pocket. "Ever notice how kids their age will handle a toy?" he said. Mitch was our next-door neighbor. He was the single father of Bobby Norman, Joshua's strange best friend. His other best friend, Chris Boschetti, came from a family of cosmetics executives. My wife had taken to calling them rich and strange. Mitch pinched the front of his shirt between his fingers and fanned himself with it. "The actual function of the toy is like some sort of obstacle," he said. "They'll dream up a new use for everything in the world." I looked across the yard at the swing set. Joshua was trying to shinny up one of the A-poles. Taylor Tugwell and Sam Yu were standing on the teeter swing. Adam Smithy was tossing fistfuls of pebbles onto the slide and watching them rattle to the ground. My wife tipped one of her sandals onto the grass with the ball of her foot. "Playing as you should isn't fun," she said. "It's design." She parted her toes around the front leg of Mitch's lawn chair. He leaned back into the sunlight, and her calf muscles tautened. My son was something of a disciple of flying things. On his bedroom wall were posters of fighter planes and wild birds. A model of a helicopter was chandeliered to his ceiling. His birthday cake, which sat before me on the picnic table, was decorated with a picture of a rocket ship, a silver-white missile with discharging thrusters. I had been hoping that the baker would place a few stars in the frosting as well. The cake in the catalog was dotted with yellow candy sequins, but when I opened the box, I found that they were missing. So this is what I did. As Joshua stood beneath the swing set, fishing for something in his pocket, I planted his birthday candles deep in the cake. I pushed them in until each wick was surrounded by only a shallow bracelet of wax. Then I called the children over from the swing set. They came tearing up divots in the grass. We sang happy birthday as I held a match to the candles. Joshua closed his eyes. "Blow out the stars," I said, and his cheeks rounded with air. That night, after the last of the children had gone home, my wife and I sat outside, drinking, each of us wrapped in a separate silence. The city lights were burning, and Joshua was sleeping in his room. A nightjar gave one long trill after another from somewhere above us. Melissa added an ice cube to her glass, shaking it against the others until it whistled and cracked. I watched a strand of cloud break apart in the sky. The moon that night was bright and full, but after a while it began to seem damaged to me, marked by some small inaccuracy. It took me a moment to realize why this was. Against its blank white surface was a square of perfect darkness. The square was without blemish or flaw, no larger than a child's tooth, and I could not tell whether it rested on the moon itself or hovered above it like a cloud. It looked as if a window had been opened clean through the floor of the rock, presenting to view a stretch of empty space. I had never seen such a thing before. "What is that?" I said. Melissa made a sudden noise, a deep, defeated little O. "My life is a mess," she said. Within a week, the object in the night sky had grown perceptibly larger. It would appear at sunset, when the air was dimming to purple, as a faint, granular blur, a certain filminess at the high point of the sky, and would remain there through the night. It blotted out the light of passing stars and seemed to travel across the face of the moon, but it did not move. The people of my town were uncertain as to whether the object was spreading or approaching. We could see only that it was getting bigger, and this matter gave rise to much speculation. Gleason the butcher insisted that it wasn't there at all, that it was only an illusion. "It all has to do with the satellites," he said. "They're bending the light from that place like a lens. It just looks like something's there." But though his manner was relaxed and he spoke with conviction, he would not look up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.